good Sunday or good day to you, depending on which day you're actually watching this. We are continuing our series of Who is Jesus? And looking at his seven I Am statements, and we are on the door. Our scripture reading is John chapter 10, verse 9. Jesus said, "I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture." So in this series, Who is Jesus? We have learned that he is the bread of life, that he is the light of the world. So our I Am statement for this week, as I said, is found in John 10. This happens to be his final public address within the Gospel of John. And in this chapter, Jesus introduces two I Am statements within verses of each other. I am the door, and I am the good shepherd. So we will be looking at the first of these today, and the good shepherd will be next week. And so this first statement that we find in John 10, I am the door, may seem strange. And as we reflect on the image of the door and the verses that are surrounding it, something profound and beautiful actually happens. In John 8, verses 58 through 59, Jesus told the Jewish people that he is God and that he had seen and revealed himself to Abraham. And they took up stones to kill him. But Jesus hid and he walked out of the temple. He said in verses 58 through 59 of John 8, "Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am." So they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. So this is what's before these two I Am statements. And he left the temple and he came across a blind man who was sitting by the road. And Jesus continues his discussion on being the light of the world in John chapter 9, specifically in verse 5 when he says, "As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." And then he heals the man of his blindness. This started a big uproar among the leaders in the temple. And when all was said and done, the healed young man went in to praise his healing, praise God for his healing. And he was kicked out of the temple. And when Jesus heard what they had done to this young man, he went and he found this young man and he presented himself as the Son of God, and the young man worshiped Jesus. This led to more discussion between the Pharisees and Jesus about their blindness, their spiritual blindness. And Jesus transitions from the image of light and darkness to that of a shepherd and sheep. So that's what bridges our gap from I am the light of the world to today, where he is the door. It's where Jesus speaks a double parable concerning who he was. So when we begin today in John 10, it will be with verses 1 through 6. "Truly I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers." This figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. A sheepfold was an area where they would take and put the sheep for the night. And being that herding was a common business or a common area to make money and to sustain their families, in the time of the Bible, the Jews would have had no problem understanding what Jesus was talking about. And these sheepfolds were sometimes created out of natural landscapes, such as a cave or some place that may have been surrounded by an outcropping of rock or brush or briars. And actually, some were built by shepherds using rock or dirt. And in these sheepfolds, there was just one door, one way to get in or out of. And when the shepherd had his sheep in the fold, he would lay himself across the door, across the entrance, and become the door. And that way they would know if anything dangerous was trying to enter, and it also kept the sheep from wandering off. And for many shepherds, they would attach the sheep fold to their homes. And so to enter the sheep fold was to come home. And to steal from it was like breaking and entering in your own house. It would be hard to find a more powerful and contrasting analogy following an interaction for a man who was just kicked out of the temple by religious leaders. Jesus was speaking of his fold of people, his people on earth, and what he does to take care of it. He calls, he leads, he goes before us. And in keeping with the light and darkness, the leaders were not able to understand the metaphor that Jesus was sharing with them. They continued to be blinded by their actions and immune to the people that they impacted. So Jesus tries again in John 10, verses 7 through 10. So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." He's the door of salvation. He is the only door. To get into Jesus's flock, into his fold, you must come through him. He's the only way that one can become part of the people of God. No other way. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. You can't lie or cheat your way into the fold. All you must do is enter through the door. And when you go through the door, you're home. And when you go through the door, you are free. You are able to go in and out, meaning that repentance and forgiveness gives us this freedom to live without guilt. And when you go through the door, you get to go to the pastures where you find rest. It makes me think of that beautiful psalm, Psalm 23, verses 2 and 3. We're all familiar with it. It says, "He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake." When we go through the door, we find abundant life, complete with fullness and with freedom. Because Jesus is the door of satisfaction. What an amazing metaphor, especially for a beggar who found himself alone and in need of a home. In John chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus said, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." We can have abundant life. It's why Jesus came. He came for us, and he is the door of safety. There were false prophets, wicked religious leaders, and of course the master thief, Satan, who comes to steal, kill, and destroy. All were hindering the belief of the Hebrew people, and unfortunately, all can be found in today's world too. For the unbeliever, Satan is out to steal any mention of God's word. In Matthew chapter 13, verse 19, it says, "When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. Satan is out to kill. Murders, suicide, carelessness, and lifestyles. He knows if he can take you out of this world before you accept Jesus, he accomplishes his goal. If he can keep you away from Jesus, he will have destroyed you. To the believer, just because you are saved, it doesn't mean that you will be left alone. If Satan tempted Jesus, he will do the same to you and to me. The devil is out to steal the fruit of the Spirit inside you. He wants you to be miserable and unhappy. So you better take note of that, because if you are miserable and you are unhappy, then you run to the door. The devil wants to kill your relationship with God. He wants to stop your calling. Anything that he can do to keep you from praying, to keep you from reading the Bible, to keep you from going to church, getting along with others, he is going to do. He wants to make sure that you will not be effective. The evil one will try to cause you to sin, maybe in ways you never thought possible, or he'll try to get you to compromise your standards. Satan will put many other doors before us. And when we find ourselves under attack, we must not only run to Jesus, run to the door, but we must trust in his protective love. We must remember which door provides safety, salvation, and satisfaction. Many of us spend our entire life searching for this. We are either choosing the wrong door, or when we find that what was promised in the world is not what was delivered, then we wander around looking for another way. Jesus said in Matthew 7, verses 7 and 8, "Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, it will be opened." The asking is prayer. Prayer is a way for us to confer with God, to speak with God, to have a relationship with God, and to express our praise, our wants, what we need. And prayer should be done often. Asking, we should pray and ask as a beggar asks alms. Lord, Lord, please help me. We should ask as a traveler asks for direction. Lord, I don't know which way to go. Guide my steps. We should be seeking things of value that we have lost or which are good. We can seek through prayer, Father, I've lost my way. Father, I'm troubled by this. Father, I need goodness. Father, I need you. And knocking. Knock as we desire to enter the house of God. Enter through the door, who is Jesus. Because whatever we pray for, according to the promise, shall be given to us, if God sees that it is right for us. Let us never suppose at all that our Heavenly Father would bid us to pray and then refuse to hear. He hears. He hears every prayer, whether it's a prayer of sorrow or joy. Let us never suppose that our Heavenly Father would bid us to pray and give us what would be hurtful or bad for us. And we may not be able to see that. When he answers our prayer, he knows what's best. And so when we knock, we need to be prepared to get the answers that may be surprising, but we know that our Heavenly Father will only give us what is best. So knock. Knock often. Go to the door and seek Jesus. Because today we can walk through the door that Jesus has opened to us, a door of safety, a door of salvation, a door of satisfaction. We can walk through the door that is open because he gave his life for us. And he gives his life to us right now. Let us pray. Father, we are grateful to have a door that is only one way in and one way out, a protective door, one that gives us satisfaction, freedom, and salvation. We sometimes fear knocking on the door, or we knock on the door and we think we're gonna know what's on the other side of it, and we must be prepared, Lord, to receive your gift of Jesus, and the promises and the grace that he has given us in ways that we may not expect, but we know will always be good. Thank you for the promise of your love and for giving us the answers to our prayers in a way that we know will be beneficial to us and not hurtful. And the promise that you hear every prayer and you will not forsake us. I ask, Lord, that you will continue to give us the strength to come to your Son, to go to the door, to ask, to seek, and to knock. In your Son Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. May you find the door of salvation, safety, and satisfaction. And may that door continue to be open to you now and forever. Be blessed.